I come in, sir?
Yes, come in.
Good evening, sir.
Good evening. Take your seat.
Thank you, sir.
Shrenik Dilip Lodha.
Yes, sir.
Tell us something about you.
So myself, Shrenik Dilip Lodha. I am from Bid district. I have completed my MBBS graduation from BJ Medical College, Sassoon General Hospital. Later, I worked for 1 year in Sassoon Hospital as an intern. And later on, I started my preparation for civil services in 2015, sir.
When did you pass out?
In 2014, sir.
14. Since then, you have been preparing for the civil services only.
Yes, sir. I prepared continuously for 2 years for civil services. And later on, I also prepared for NEET PG for post-graduations, for which result is awaited yet. And it will come on 31st of January, sir.
So you have done your graduation in medical field, which is considered to be a very noble field. And as a doctor, as a medical practitioner, you could be of great service and help to the humanity at large. People who suffer from various diseases, ailments, they treat doctors as demigods because they come as their saviors. So why did you decide to leave such a noble job and didn't pursue this career to opt for the civil services?
Yes, sir. With that intention, I started my job in Sassoon General Hospital. And we used to treat many patients which used to come for malnutrition or pneumonia kind of diseases. Also, we started our work in Melghat region, in tribal area, in Yavatmal district. But later on, we realized that we were just providing symptomatic treatment. The root cause of these problems lied somewhere else, such as if we take for malnutrition. So, due to lack of proper sanitation facility, poor drinking water supply, and a lack of employment, people were suffering, or small children were suffering from malnutrition. So rather than treating just disease, our intention or the thought process which was going was to go to the root cause of problem and try to solve this. So civil services, I thought, would provide that opportunity to work on the root cause and to bring about some visible change into that situation, and which would benefit a larger section of society. So this was the thought process which was going on before choosing this civil service.
Are you aware of one or two doctors of Maharashtra who have opted to quit urban centers and settle down in rural areas, and they have done a human service, a tremendous work in the rural areas, and so many villages, so many establishments, they have able to bring about radical changes in the field of Medicare. Are you aware of such personalities? Did they not inspire you?
Yes, sir. They were also inspiration, but some of the seniors from our college also, they started and they prepared for civil service and they entered into the services, such as Sri Shikhar Padeshi, sir, Ayas Tamboli, sir. And they are doing the great job in Chhattisgarh district for in tribal areas. So that were the initial motivation which drew us towards civil services, sir.
What are the maladies of Indian bureaucracy?
So the most important, which I think is the, sir, the political interference which occurs into the civil services, that is one important thing. Later on, there are also some various regulations, rules, regulations, which inhibit civil servants to take some policy decisions. Along with that, there are a few question marks raised on the excessive discretionary powers and which civil servants hold, and which is creating some problems, hurdles in implementing these policies as well. So these are some of the problems with civil services facing, sir.
There are certain disturbing trends which are also emerging, like aligning with political parties, one political party or the other political party, favoring colleagues from the same community or a group of communities. Are they not eating into the vitals of your efficiency and efficacy of bureaucracy?
Yes, sir. I think, sir, it violates some of the important principles of important value system which are needed for civil services, such as non-partisanship and being neutrality. So these are some of the trends which are visible, but we cannot generalize that everyone in civil services is being aligned completely towards some political parties. Sir.
So but there is are generally issues. Very often we see any change in political guard, then there is a change in the bureaucratic setup also. People who matter, who decide the policies, they also get shifted irrespective of their credentials. Suppose if you get into the civil service, and you are asked to reform this bureaucracy, what concrete measures you will take to bring about reformation in bureaucracy?
Yes, sir, I think the reform should begin from the process of appointment itself. So, like, there are some various committees which have recommended reformation in the process of examination also. Along with that, the second ARC committee, second ARC report on ethics and governance. So, they have recommended to have code of ethics, a concrete code of ethics for civil servants and bureaucrats, so that it can help them guide in decision making and avoid ethical dilemmas which hinder decision making. So,
suppose you are posted in a district which is steeped in corruption. How will you eliminate corruption, being a district magistrate of that particular district?
Sir, I think we need to work on multiple fronts to tackle corruption, and there should be the district magistrate should lead from the front. So, and the most important thing would be to promote transparency into the system, how the government is, how the district administration is functioning. Along with that, we also need to have some involvement of people into explaining them how the system is working and where the funds are being utilized, such as promotion of social audit and involving citizen in the process of ensuring accountability. So these new institutions should be promoted so that it can reduce some discretionary powers and ensure transparency and accountability. Along with that, there are various rules and legal provisions which have been enacted by government, such as RTI. So proper implementation of RTI, promotion of its awareness, these are also very essential in ensuring accountability and reducing corruption. Along with that, sir, we also need to set good examples and to punish those people who are involved in corruption. So it acts as a deterrence mechanism, so that the corrupt people or corrupt officials, they deter from entering into such malpractices.
Okay, thank you.
So how many medical colleges are there in India? Do you have any idea?
No, sir. Exact number, sorry.
And in Maharashtra?
In Maharashtra, there are 18 government colleges.
It has been observed that medical colleges these days, they do not produce good doctors. Your comment?
Yes, sir. There has been this constant complaint that the quality of doctor which are coming out from medical colleges has been deteriorating, and this has been reported by various committees as well. But there are various factors responsible for this. First of all, I think there is mushrooming of various private colleges without proper regulation and regulatory checkup. And so they are coming up, and the quality of teaching which they are providing is of a very poor quality. Along with that, there are also various colleges where proper infrastructure or proper teaching facility is not available for the students. Along with that, there is issue also of private institutions taking a lot of capitation fees and allowing students who have not qualified this exam. So these are some of the reasons for poor performance of the upcoming new doctors. So there is some issue about this.
Okay. Suppose if somebody gets degree from some foreign country, MBBS degree, can he directly practice in India?
So there is one provision that they would have to pass one exam, the entrance exam, and if they qualify that exam, they are allowed to practice in India. Such as people from China and Russia, they have to come, give you an exam of MCI, and then they are eligible for practice.
No, they are not. There is some reform being suggested by certain doctors, and they want some change through MCI in this policy. Do you have any idea about this?
No, sir. About that exam, I don't have.
You don't have. There might be some exemption or something like that. Do you have any idea about that? No problem. Have you read today's newspaper?
Yes, sir.
Any newspaper from Maharashtra or news concerning Maharashtra?
Yes. The news which is coming in last 2-3 days is about the dance bar issue and the Supreme Court ruling on that particular.
And also some news regarding that 38 engineering, 38 colleges, they have almost abolished engineering courses. Any idea about that?
Not particularly about that issue, but generally the AITCE, they have recommended that no new engineering college should be allowed since 2021. So that issue is going that 50% of the engineering seats have remained vacant, and traditional courses such as civil engineering, mechanical engineering are being abandoned, and people are preferring new courses such as in artificial intelligence, big data, cloud engineering. So those courses are becoming attractive. So in larger context, if you look, this is...
I have picked up this news from some newspaper from Maharashtra today. It was today's news. Okay, no problem. What do you know about AAP, AAP?
AAP is one of the regional political party which has evolved from the non-corruption, anti-corruption movement in Delhi, and they have fought election in Delhi, and they are currently governing the Delhi State Assembly, and they are governing in Delhi.
Okay, and it has something to do with Maharashtra?
No, sir. Sorry.
Okay, no problem. One more thing, and that is Simbex. Have you heard of Simbex?
Simbex, yes, sir. It is an exercise, military exercise between India and I think it's, Singapore. I cannot remember.
Okay, no problem. 2+2?
2+2 dialogue. Yes, it is a foreign relation dialogue between two officials from India and two officials from USA, basically External Affairs Ministry and Defense.
It is USA or Australia?
So we are having with USA as well.
Achha, what is Dharm, that is Guardian? Dharm Guardian?
No, sir. Sorry, sir. I don't have it.
Achha, one last question. That is regarding your India for Humanity. It is being observed to celebrate birth anniversary of Mahatma Gandhi. What is this?
Sorry, sir.
Something to do with artificial limbs or fitment of artificial limbs? Do you have any idea?
No, sir. I have not heard about it.
Shrenik.
Yes, sir.
Shrenik, can you please tell me what a Shrenik means?
Sir, Shrenik means being organized, and it has derived from the word Shreni, which were present in ancient.
And what was Shreni in ancient India?
Sir, there were various guilds which used to be organized, and they used to conduct their particular occupation, such as Nankanis and Dadanis. So they were practicing particular professions such as trading business, or there were some were merchants.
So how is Shreni different from Varna?
Sir, Varna system is the caste system which is based on the notion of how from which community the particular person is born. But Shreni is derived from the profession, and they are organized. If a particular person from any community, if he enters into that profession, so they would be considered as a member of Shreni. So it is based on profession, and the Varna system is based on the birth.
I can see that you worked for Andhrashraddha Nirmulan Samiti. Can Shraddha be cited? Shraddha has to be Andh, isn't it?
Yes, sir. Of course, there is very fine line between what is Shraddha and what is Andhashraddha. So, but Shraddha should be there, and we also are not completely against any kind of Shraddha. But the issue comes when we start believing, even after providing the proof, scientific proof, that particular incident or particular thing is happening because of some supernatural forces. And even if a person believes in that the particular thing is happening because of supernatural forces, they have the complete right to believe in that. But our intention or aim is to provide some scientific reason or scientific basis behind those Shraddha or behind those thought belief. If there is no scientific basis for it, we just try to explain the logic behind particular events or why one should not practice those events. It's all completely depends on person's wish to practice it or not.
Since you're working in the same area, even geographically the same area where the people working against superstitions got killed, you know, the Kulbergi, you know, other people, Gauri Lankesh and all. This is despite the fact that our constitution provides for scientific temper as in the DPSPs.
Yes.
When you look at it from the perspective of Gauraksha and other things, do you believe that we are defying our own constitution, the very state which was supposed to protect it by very straight, which was supposed to protect it.
Sir, I personally feel everyone has a right to practice or to profess their own belief, but along with that, it should be ensured that no one takes law and order into their own hand, or they start using force or violence against a particular type of community, and on the basis of it, inflicting communalism or communal hatred against particular community. If this is kept into check, sir, then everyone has the right to practice and profess their
Everyone religions. Probably has the right, but should state be indulging it to professing or promoting religion? The way we look at it in case of Gauraksha, or for that matter, say Kumbh, where for a spiritual religious collection, you're actually spending crores of rupees, ending up actually promoting the same things you're fighting against.
Sir, I personally feel the kind of secularism or the concept which we have adopted is to treat every religion equally. So if the state is treating all the religions equally or providing funds for them, then I don't think anything is wrong in that, sir. But if it is happening or it is consciously being promoted or supporting any particular one religion, then of course it goes against the constitutional values which has been enshrined in our sacred books.
Recently in a country in Africa, there was a campaign going on, Gandhi must call. What was this campaign, and what were the main objections of that youth of that nation?
So this campaign was going on in some African countries, and their basic argument...
Can you name the country?
So I think it is Nigeria.
Ghana.
Sorry, sir. So their main argument was that during the early phases, Gandhi's views were some kind of racist. They promoted racism. So this value should not be propagated further, or we should not celebrate Gandhi as a some kind of as a hero. So on that basis, they were recommending that Gandhiji's values or Gandhiji's, this campaign was basically started.
So you agree with Gandhiji or not? Agree with this movement or not?
No, sir. I think it is completely based on, I do not subscribe to these views, sir, basically, because these, some of the views which they have expressed, basically it is cherry picking a few facts and placing them out of context. We should analyze Gandhiji's views by taking into consideration his complete life journey and the modification of his views which later went on as he fought for the struggle in South Africa.
Shrenik, you are a medical science graduate. In a CBC, if the lymphocytes are raised, what does it mean?
Ma'am, in CBC, the lymphocyte count is, lymphocytes are particularly one type of white blood cells. So if lymphocytes are raised, it indicates that there is a chronic infection which is going on.
If neutrophils are raised?
Ma'am, it is about acute infection which is present.
If eosinophils are raised?
Ma'am, it is allergic reaction.
Okay. What is the doctor-patient ratio in India?
Ma'am, currently the doctor-patient ratio is 1:2, one doctor for 1,600 patients. And the WHO requirement is about one doctor for 1,000.
And what do you think about the rural and urban distribution of doctors in India?
According to recently, there was in 2016 a Lancet report which was published, and it pointed out the maldistribution of doctors in rural and urban area. It showed that 75% of population resides in rural area, but rural area has only 25% of doctors. Compared to urban population, where 25% of population, or according to recent 30% population, but it has 70% of doctors concentration in urban areas.
What would you do to correct this?
Ma'am, one of the important reason why doctors are not preferring to go to rural area is about the various facility or poor infrastructure which is present in primary healthcare centers, and lack of incentive available to them. Along with that, there are also some security reasons to go into rural and tribal area regions. So we need to address these problems, madam. So,
but why is it so that doctors like you are willing to go to a distant village as civil servant, but not as doctors, though salaries are nearly the similar? there's not much difference in government salaries.
Ma'am, I think it is not just about salary, but the quality of job and the future career progressions which civil services which provides, and the difference which it can bring by solving some of the problems is immense in civil services. So,
India needs more doctors or more civil servants? One line answer.
India needs both, ma'am.
Both. We have a lot of options in civil servants. Again, rethink. India needs more doctors or more civil servants?
India needs both, ma'am.
You are a Jain. Jainism subscribes to the idea of God?
Yes, ma'am. Jainism subscribes to the idea, but they considered them below to Jina, ma'am.
Who is a Jina?
Jina basically is the name given to Mahavira, and the follower of them are called as Jainas.
What is Syadvad of Jainism?
Syadvad basically believes in the philosophy that there are multiple dimensions to the truth, and there is no one truth available. So anyone can perceive truth according to their belief or their experience. So this is the basic philosophy behind the Syadvad.
So let's see that can Syadvad also include the ideology or the ideas of a criminal? Because they can also come under Syadvad.
Ma'am, we cannot think or look at Syadvad from only one perspective or in isolation. There are other various philosophies of Jainism such as truth, ahimsa, non-violence, or the other five truths of Jainism. So I think we need to look holistically towards Syadvad rather than in isolation.
Okay, compare euthanasia and Santhara.
Ma'am, Santhara is a voluntary decision which is taken to renounce the world, and it is a highest level of spiritual experience which the person has or person gets, and he tries to or he wants to achieve the highest level of spiritual experience, so he renounces the world. If we compare it with euthanasia, it is taken to reduce the pain, physical pain which is occurring, which occurs due to any medical condition. Euthanasia cannot or may not compulsorily involve voluntary choice, because the patient is in vegetative state, and the someone else takes the responsibility or the decision to end.
So, isn't it a little hypocritical that you support Santhara as a spiritual experience while you are a rationalist, because you were part of a organization which supported rationalism?
Ma'am, supporting rationalism doesn't mean to oppose the essential practices of any particular religion. Rationalism is a very broader concept which tries to inculcate the sense, inculcate the habit of questioning things, asking questions or raising critical questions, and then trying to achieve, trying to reach towards the truth. So
can Santhara be forced?
No, ma'am. Santhara cannot be.
Can Santhara be forced? There was some news that in Rajasthan, few areas are there where old people are forced to take Santhara.
No, ma'am. Santhara cannot be forced, and it should be completely on the basis of voluntariness rather than just as a convenient means to reduce the pain of family.
Okay.
Shrenik.
Yes, sir.
Are you aware of this DNA technology regulation bill? Can you show some light on that?
Sir, recently parliament was government was planning to introduce the bill to regulate DNA technologies. So basic philosophy behind some provisions in the bill were that they will establish a DNA regulatory board. Along with that, there will also be state boards, and every the data which is being collected during from the samples of people will be stored into a central bank, and it will be regulated, and it will the data will be stored into this bank. The sample will be collected mostly from the people who are involved in some serious criminal offenses, and they will be used for some matching of this DNA so as to implicate them in
consider that I am one of the suspect, and then my DNA sample has been taken, and then it has been used into the investigation of the crime, and then I come clean out of it. So what will happen to that data which is stored over there?
Sir, there are some questions raised about this, whether the data will be completely stored or whether it will be eliminated or it will be deleted. So there are some questions raised that this data may be used for some other purposes, or it will lead to violation of privacy. At present,
what kind of privacy issue a DNA data can have?
So there are various personal information which are embedded into DNA, such as which genetic diseases may occur into a particular, are prevalent in those genetic makeup. So this information, the person may want to keep it with himself and not to expose it to the world. So this information can get leaked into.
Okay, fine. So you have been a member of the society which basically fight against this superstition and all. Recently, we saw in India that there were many part of the India where the vaccination program was not up to mark, right?
Yes, sir.
And then for that, government has already planned a mission Indradhanush. You know about it?
Yes, sir.
So what is a doctor's take? That how can we resolve this situation? I mean, what you can do as a doctor and as a rational person, where you need to convince the people, entire people, to get into the vaccination program and the health related, let's say, plans and policies.
So I think there was issue regarding the measles, mumps and rubella vaccine. So there was misconception among people that this vaccine will lead to some kind of infection or paralysis into their children. So they were hesitant to take this vaccination program. So as a doctor, sir, I think this we need to target this miscommunication, and this can be done by bringing some good doctors and who can explain them in their local language about in local language how this vaccination is helpful for their children, first of all. Along with that, we can also take help of some of the some renowned people in from that locality to promote awareness and to remove this misconception. Along with that, if it is possible, sir, if suppose in future if the doctor himself they themselves come and bring their children to and they vaccinate in front of people, so it will create a positive outlook towards this vaccination. So it will change, help in changing the attitude, sir. So these things we need to promote, sir.
What is your take on GM crops? I mean, it's been decades we have been growing GM crops, but only BT cotton.
Yes.
We tried this food crops also, GM food crops, but then we stopped it. So should it be there or not?
So personally, I think GM crop, looking at the condition of India and the malnutrition prevalent into our country and the future need which is going to arise due to rise of population, GM crop is a must and it is very essential. But along with that, there are some misconceptions that GM crop will lead to rise in immunological diseases in people. Along with that, it will lead to erosion of the genetic diversity which is present and we will not have our basic or we can say the original variety or the wild variety of species, they will get destroyed. So
do we use any wild variety in the cropping pattern, I mean agriculture system?
There are some genetic makeups, genetic genes into this variety which can help us to make the crop the drought prone, drought resistant. So there is concern that this may get eroded or it may get wiped out due to this GM crops. But along with that, we need a strong regulatory mechanism that this GM crops, proper research is conducted on GM crops, all data is being presented, and if the result shows that there is no such health impact on the humans and on the ecology, so we can surely adopt this technology, because other nations, our neighboring nations such as Bangladesh, they have adopted it and they are doing wonders, sir.
Okay. Many of the things which is there in medical and drugs, cosmetics, that is being governed by Drug and Cosmetics Act. Recently, stem cell, ministry has suggested that stem cells should be included into Drugs and Cosmetic Act. So what will be the impact of it? Why should we include stem cell therapy and the stem cell technology into Drugs and Cosmetics Act?
Sorry, sir, I'm not aware about.
Okay. What is drug-eluting stent?
Sir, drug-eluting stents are the stents which are placed into the blocked arteries of heart, and they are coated with some drugs which prevent blockage of arteries or formation of clot into these arteries. So, these stents are more beneficial than the normal metallic stents which are placed into heart. So
okay, recently what happened that this drug eluting stent, the price was, it gone down.
Yes.
So under what provision we did it?
Sir, under DPCO, Drug Price Control Order, government has passed that order to bring this this stent, drug eluting stent, under essential medicine list, which was published in 2013. So because of that, there has been some regulations on the prices of stents. So the price of stents has come down.
One last question. What is CRISPR-Cas9?
So this is the new gene editing technology which has been introduced, which helps in the cutting, precise cutting of the DNA at the location which we require. And this DNA can, this piece of DNA can be transferred into other cells. So this will be very essential in GM technologies, GM crop, and for gene editing. Basically.
Okay.
In Mahabharata, it is said that Kauravas had 100 children. Scientifically, was that possible during that period to have 100 children? Some of our leaders, they claim, yes, this technology was there during the time of Mahabharata, stem cell technology. Do you agree with this?
Sir, I personally think it is a mythological text and it should be taken into that context. 100 children from a particular, from a single woman, scientifically and from the proven research, it is not possible, sir.
Through this technology, it's not possible to have as many number as possible.
So at present, we have that technology, but to claim that that technology was present some 3000 or 2000 years ago, that sounds, that doesn't click the logic, or it doesn't stand the test of rationality, sir.
Chalo, one last question. I'm a person of 50 years age, I'm suffering from hypertension, I'm suffering from diabetes. I come to you as a doctor. Doctor, you prescribe me some medicines so that I can bring my hypertension to a desired level and all that. You have to tell me and convince me that medicine is no remedy. I should be doing something else by which I can bring down my levels of diabetes and hypertension. What will you suggest to me?
Sir, first of all, I would like to explain the basic reasons or basic causes which leads to development of hypertension and diabetes, such as hypertension is led due to sedentary lifestyle, excessive stress, and due to age-related factor. Or diabetes also can contribute to heart disease. Along with that, similarly, I will explain the basic causes of diabetes mellitus, or how we can naturally, or by avoiding drugs, we can control them. So if we explain the science behind this diseases or why they occur, then it will be very easy to convince what other modalities which we can take to control this diseases without taking the route of, without taking the help of medicines. Such as for diabetes, we can start with modification of diet, reducing carbohydrates and increasing protein and fats. Along with that, we can start doing exercises which will increase our body's response to insulin levels, and which will increase the muscle's response to insulin levels, which will reduce the blood sugar levels. So by providing some logical reasons, we can convince. I hope I can convince you.
Thank you very much. Your interview is over.
Thank you.
So, what is your impression of the interview?
It was quite grilling also, but I think few of the questions I fumbled and could not explain it properly, such as DNA regulatory bill and related to superstition, the difference between Shraddha and Andhashraddha. So, few points I think I fumbled a bit, sir. And few questions I could not answer. Actual question.
Find your performance was very good. Interview has gone off very well.
Thank you, sir.
You have a good personality.
Thank you.
Honesty of purpose is there. You appear to be a man of integrity and well dressed also. Pleasing personality, smiling face. Only thing which has bothered me and my colleagues is your movement of, there's too much of movement of hands.
Okay.
That movement has to be contained.
It's a strange pattern. You do it with the hand, then alternatively you do with the other hand.
Because what happens, you are addressing the other side. Other side is watching you. Maybe very natural to you, but try to restrain that habit. Because whatever good you are speaking, that gets negated by this movement of hands. And it is moves very frequently, up and down, up and down. So that if it is possible, try to avoid
it. It was hypertension, it was diabetes.
there's a way you speak. I can imagine.
Actually,
that.
You need to understand, this side of the table is very boring. If you look carefully, but we don't have much work to do. The only thing we do is watching the candidate. So we are forced to watch you we are forced to look at you more intensely and all. And that's why these things sometimes appear magnified.
Okay. That was an excellent interview. When is your interview?
On 13th February.
13th.
You
will do well.
Your collar is buttoned.
Sir, that
कर लीजिएगा वहाँ पर.
It is not fitting, sir. Actually.
ऐसी shirt कर लीजिए. हाँ, ऐसी shirt लीजिएगा जिसमें button बंद किया जा सके.
But you are almost a ready material.
Thank you, sir. Thank you.
So wish you all the best.
Thank you, sir. Thank you very much.
All the best.
Thank you, sir.